let's do this. I'd like to finish up talking about OpenSCAD. There's we could actually spend the whole semester talking about this, and I think I would be really entertained doing that, but possibly no one else. review. What do you remember about OpenSCAD from last week? We did OpenSCAD last week. 1 week ago. This is the problem with Tuesday, Thursday class. It's a long, long like gap. And then on Thursday, we talked about slicing, and then we looked at some 3D printers. So yeah, it feels like a really long gap. So what do you know about OpenSCAD? I see I've got a blinking command prompt. That sounds like it's a programming language. That's good. It's marketed as the programmer's 3D modeler. Yeah, so again, the competitors to OpenSCAD, there's two big classes. One is CAD programs, and the other is sort of 3D modeling programs. So Blender is a 3D modeling program, which is great for pulling in scans of 3D objects or worrying about rendering objects. CAD programs actually will let you work equally precisely. So for example here, the sort of typical things you do in OpenSCAD would be I drop in a cylinder. I have to spell it correctly. So I'm going to set the diameter of the cylinder, and I'm going to set it in OpenSCAD doesn't care what units you're using, but if you're printing it, you really got to know what the units are. So I always work in millimeters at this point. So you know you can make so up primitive is a cylinder. Cylinder by default is aligned along the z-axis. Now in practice, so I use OpenSCAD all the time to make robot parts. So there's a million parts for robots. So for example, here's a motor. And you have to imagine there's something on the motor. But this is a recurring problem in doing actual robotics. Like, all you need is you need this motor held at a particular location relative to the frame. And you know maybe you can move parts of the frame around, but like it's a cylinder, right? One of the things I use 3D printing for more than almost anything is making brackets for things. This actually turns out to be a really common thing you need. So how do we make a bracket to hold a cylinder, and in particular hold it onto like a 1-inch steel tube?
You create a structure around the cylinder and you make the cylinder negative.
Yep.
So you have a hole created by the cylinder.
So here's the motor.
Preferably with extra holes for things like axles and drive shaft.
Actually, I always realize, the motor plugs right in there, this is great, and then I need wires for the motor to do anything. Yeah, very important. And then, I need an encoder, and now I have the motor just swaddled in stuff, so the motor's overheating. So I actually need either like air cooling channels, or complexity ends up happening here. So I just made this thing a module. So this is OpenSCAD's way of letting you build big, complicated, but maintainable systems, is that you can give things names. And I'm amazed that giving things names is technology that is not universal. There's actually G-code, which is kind of the, this CAD, we're gonna export as STL. That's the 3D shape. STL you're going to slice into the G-code is the control instructions for the printer. G-code does not let you name variables, modules. It's actually quite ridiculous. But we can name this thing. So this is the idea is this is the hole for the motor. So what I want is basically it's going to end up being a difference. So we're going to do a difference between the lots of options here. So for example, I could do a giant cube. This is going to look awful, but I'm going to do it anyway. So let's see. So giant cube and the motor hole. So this is actually several kind of silly things about this. So okay, great. We've got our bracket set up. That's the part I'm printing. That seems silly. This is not a good idea. Well, A, we need to center the cube. So hopefully, okay, so great, we got our motor bracket. Actually, it's got, there's no space for the wires underneath, but that's what we chose. Good and bad things about this. The motor is held. It's on there. Actually, I've had cases where if I have a plate and I want to mount the motor horizontally relative to the plate, it's actually fine. Like I can just print a quote unquote solid object. turn the infill down so it's like mostly, you know, got material on the outside edges and it's fairly thin in the middle. And then I can just put screws, self-tapping screws, right into the 3D printed object. And it's not quite, I mean, it's kind of feels, starts to feel subtractive and somehow feels wrong. Actually, if you back the screws out a few times, the plastic starts getting really shredded. Like a piece of wood that you've, you know, put nails in and then torn them out and then put them in and it turns into just a splintery mess. But basically, like, this is maybe a semi-plausible way to do it. It's just not real volume efficient. And in particular, right, if you want to have something that's holding the motor, you probably just want basically the size of the motor plus a little bit. In particular, maybe I might have a global parameter. So usually you want to have a couple of global parameters out here. So I usually have one called wall thickness. So this is basically like, you know, it's so 2 millimeter thick is, it's actually fairly thick. If I was really concerned about weight, I might drop wall thickness down to 1 or, you know, 0.7 or something. Like you can, and it would just be a single layer. If it had to be really beefy, it's getting, you know, it's getting dragged through the ground or something, then maybe, you know, 4 or 5 millimeter wall thickness. Seems like diminishing returns at some point. Like an inch of plastic is still going to die if it really gets smashed on. So it's something like 2 millimeter wall thickness. So the basic idea here is I'm going to try. So the outside of this hole should basically just be 2 millimeters thicker than the inside. So several ways to do this. This is the unmaintainable way to do it. Okay, 34 plus 2 times the wall thickness would be 38. And then the height, so the height is a little bit weird because we just need to translate down. So I'm going to go by minus the wall thickness. And then I'm going to do this. So this is unmaintainable because, so we get the, you know, this little much more volume efficient, right, wrapper around the motor. So that's cool. The downside here is this, if we go and we print it and it turns out the motor, actually, this is true for a lot of these things. The motor has like different diameters at different locations. Now, immediately, you're gonna say, "Well, yeah." So the deal is, the motor is it's 34 in the bottom, but then if you translate up a little bit, it's got this little sort of it's got like love handles around the sides. So this happens to a lot of older motors. Yeah. So you can see that basically we, you know, we take a little bit more material off, but actually now my walls are thinner than I had sort of intended. So this may actually be a big problem. Or if you go and change motors, right? If I want to swap up motors, then I have to go and just change all these hard-coded constants. So ideally, in fact, what you have is anytime you have a part, you want to be able to make like space around the part. So in 2D, this is actually really easy to do because there's an offset command that just fattens up an existing shape. So I could say, like, start with the motor and then, you know, offset, you know, make it wall thickness bigger. In 3D, there is nothing really like that. There's a cool operation called Minkowski that we need to talk about it actually gets misused for this a lot. And it's relatively effective for it. It's just really slow and tends to break on complicated geometry, neither of which you want. So what I want is I want to be able to have the motor, and I want to have basically to be able to fatten up the motor in order to build like walls around the motor. Because ideally, right, if the motor has this sort of step profile, then the bracket around the motor should also have that same step profile. How would you do this? Yeah. So really what I want to be able to do is I want to be able to add, so this is like this extra like outsideness. So one way to do this, I can have a parameter called outside that starts off at 0. If outside becomes 1, then I'm going to fatten this thing up by the wall diameter. I don't know, several ways to do this. You could call this like the fattening. So fatten would be the amount of extra space you want to add. So this is kind of a nice way to do it because different printers, like maybe if I have a motor that I want to be able to add and remove really easily, maybe I add extra space, so I just fatten up the hole a little bit, and then it's got more wiggle room for the motor to drop in there. And so basically, I just have to go through each of the dimensions here and be able to parametrically change it. And then the cool part here is that when I want to make the walls, I just make a motor, and it's not really the hole anymore. This is actually just the external shape of the motor. And I'm going to do motor shape. So motor shape of 0 basically gives me a hole with no extra space. And you know, for me to cram the motor in there, I should probably have a little bit of extra space. So here I'm just going to have the wall thickness.
Yeah,
I guess.
Extra space, though. Aren't you going to not have support necessary?
Maybe it's better just lock the thing down. So
well, I mean,
yeah.
I was just thinking that if you got a nice big hole, that the motor itself will spin.
Yeah. Let's see. So let's see if we've done this correctly. Now you can see that there's another problem here. So I'm gonna do another difference here of a cube, just so you can see the cross section here. So I'm gonna chop a big cube out of this whole shape, like that. So we can look at the cross section. So I don't know if you can see what's happening. The edge profile is kind of screwed up here. So in order to make the wall, we translated everything down, which is a plausible way to do it, except we translated the wall down, and this inner corner up here, that one is doing the wrong thing, right? So we translated the outside down, and that meant that we have bad news happening there. And this is actually just because if I fatten, you actually have to fatten up the heights as well. So for example, I might do 40 plus 2 times. And it is actually kind of silly that this stuff is it should be automatable. So in particular, if I translate, I'm gonna translate the start points down, and I'm gonna increase the heights of everything. So if you fatten, the thing just gets honestly bigger. So now I don't have to do any wacky translations. So I'm gonna start with motor shape inflated in all directions by the wall thickness. So this is great. So now I have it's actually unfortunately more like a hand grenade shape now, because there's no shape for the motor to get inserted. So several ways to do this. Actually, there are times when, like, I want to do a clamshell and the motor like gets stuck in there, and then it just gets encased on all sides. Totally doable. There are other times you don't want that, and several different ways to do this. So for example, I could just add a cylinder hole. So after the fact here, I could just poke in a, if the shaft is that big and I'm going to somehow get this thing in here. So this is just going to be a huge cylinder that's going to just tear a hole out. And so it starts all the way down there, and it just shoots up through everything. So you can, again, for debugging this stuff, hash will show you the geometry you're subtracting away there, right? So what I did is just blasted a hole for, there's a little indexing nodule there. So conceivably, right, this is a reasonable print. If I can figure some way to get the motor in there. Actually, in particular, you can imagine this has never worked very well when I've tried it. So this print completely encases the motor, so there's no way for the motor to get out. So I can't insert the motor or remove it again afterwards, which is a pain in the butt. So what I may want to do, in fact, is basically just print this thing, and if I'm printing it bottom up, there's some point right here where conceivably I could just put the motor into the print, and then hopefully the print head will not ram into any of the projecting parts of the motor as it does the rest of the print. So the only way I know how to do this is basically go so save the STL, slice it, go into the G code, and find where the I should show you how I would do this. So I'm going to export an STL file. So I just pressed F6 to get myself an actual honest-to-goodness render of this thing. I guess I should probably save this. So this is the motor demo. So I am going to export that thing as an STL. So we just saved an STL file. So hopefully here in the slicer I can... So I'm going to load up my STL file in the slicer. There it is. So that's the object I'm going to print. I go ahead and export G code. So I get the G code. So this is how the thing prints. You notice I may need support material. Maybe the motor itself acts as support material. I don't know what's going to happen in this overhangs here. So I'm just going to edit motor demo. Actually,
I guess the motor would act as support material. It is
think what would kill you there would be the fact that there's this gearbox sticking up. Would probably mess you up completely. So this is what these G-code files look like. They're just ASCII text. This is basically the machine code for the printer. Some of these are actually quite easy. G1 is go with doing actual stuff. So it's basically just the X, Y coordinate, and then where what the extruder should be extruding. So basically the printer's control firmware is just reading through this G-code file and it's saying, go to this XY position and extrude this amount of stuff. You notice we haven't mentioned Z here. And this is traditionally, you print one layer of Z at a time. So usually there's a G1Z. So this is the very first, the first layer is a 0.6. I think I do an extra fat first layer and apparently my slicer profile has a built-in like 0.1 millimeter offset. You can fix your, if your Z axis is not quite totally zeroed, you can say go to 0.6 instead of 0.5. To start with. So I 0.5 millimeter thick first layer, and then the next layer, so if you just do a find for G1Z, so this is actually every one of the layer changes. So next layer is at 0.9, let's see. Oh no, that's actually a, what it lifts, it moves to some new spot, so that's actually just a retract style lift. Oh, these are gonna be annoying. I put in a G-code comment. Actually, this is inside the slicer. Somewhere here, you can set custom G-code somewhere. So you can so I actually put in a grappable, findable word there, swap layer. So this is pretty easy to so you just tell the slicer to stick this in every time you do a layer change. So as it increments through here, so basically swap layers is what I'm after. Oh, and then the other thing I'm doing here, I actually go to the corner of my bed, I rehome my X and Y, and then zoom back to the middle of the bed. This really saves your butt on a big, complicated print when it's halfway up, it's making some giant thing, and it loses steps. You end up with a geometry that ends up getting split off in the middle. So I have a little bit of code to kind of compensate for that. But basically, so swap layer is actually going to be every one of the layer switches. So if you see it down to the very end, I mean, the last thing it does is actually does these machine control commands. And I can never remember what the numbers are for G-code. This is almost like machine code for CNC, right? It's not particularly human readable, but it's kind of the final output stage of the printer, the printer's hitting. So all I would do is I'm going to go back up to find the swap layer. So let's see. So the next to the last swap layer is there. So you can figure out what the Z coordinate is at the point where I'm interested in dropping my object in. So it's probably about 73 or so. So let's see. So there's 72, 71.5. So this may be about it. So before I home, I'm actually going to, this does a G0, so it goes as fast as possible to the corner of the bed, X equals 15, Y equals 15. And then, I guess it's gonna rehome. So what I'm gonna do is here is just put in a machine pause, and I am totally blanking on what exactly a pause looks like. So there's some simple, yes, you can use the pause command. So you M226, so easy to remember. So I just put it in M226, and then the idea is ideally, the printer gets to that point, it's gonna zoom back, it's gonna get the hot end out of the way, and then it's gonna wait there. And then the idea is that I basically realize the printer stopped, go and I can now drop the motor in. And then you cross your fingers and you say go on the printer control interface, and then hopefully it goes and it'll just reprint the rest of the stuff. In practice, what tends to happen when I do this is like either I go to drop the motor in and I realize like crunch, 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 oh my gosh, I can't cram the motor in. Like Normally you could clean the thing up by taking the part and sticking it on a lathe and like boring out any extra crud. So then I go and I grab my chisel and like the printer's on, it's all calibrated and ready to go, but I'm like trying to chisel stuff out of the middle and the, you know, the, and you're working over the hotbed. This is not a real safe or easy sort of thing to do. And in particular, if you imagine like, oh, I'm going to make a whole robot that's printed as one solid print, and all the 14 different motors and 137 different fasteners I'm just going to put in there, like, that's going to be like a long print where, this super user-friendly way to just scroll through the G-code and manually munch stuff where you want. I have written software. It's actually fairly easy to write software that basically just reads a line of G-code, looks to see if it's a Z-move. If it's a Z-move, then it knows it may have to, you know, put in, splice in some more stuff. Tooling is kind of lame for that. Actually, the ideal thing would be to have a little hopper full of motors somewhere, and the hot end gets out of the way, and then the little robot arm grabs the parts and then sticks it in the print, and then the hot end just automatically starts encasing it in filament, and there you go. So totally possible. Actually pulling it off is, I have successfully, you can embed nuts and things into prints fairly easily, because they're flat, right? That you basically make a little nut-shaped hexagonal hole. You just stick, and especially if you get four nuts to do, but they're all at the same plane, you only got to monkey around with the G-code to find the right spot to do it at one time, and then you just basically stick all the nuts in, and then say go, and then you get these nice steel rethreadable inserts in there, and it's kind of a fun wacky way to do things, and you can make like totally blind holes with a steel nut inside there that's just like. The nut is never going to come out. It's never going to vibrate out. I don't think this is the right approach for this one, actually. So I think I just want to have an open shape on the top where the motor can drop in there. So several ways to do this. So for example, I think we did this for the bolt last time. I could have an insert parameter that starts off being zero. And then basically when I'm doing the hole for the motor, so this is the hole and this is the outside, then basically I'm going to say, when you have the hole, we need insertion distance. So insertion, and I'm going to have to drop that whole motor in there. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to make the cylinders taller. So insert, is what I'm just going to add here. So what this should do is each of the holes should actually get a lot bigger, and I'm going to highlight that. So let's see, get rid of that cylinder. So do a hash to show the object. So you can see now my holes are blasting, this big extra space up above. This seems a little weird. Maybe we don't need that last little piece of plastic around there. Like you could hold the base of the motor and then just not worry about the top, for example. So you can set this thing up. I mean, the cool part about doing this is that I can, for example, go ahead and swap out motors here and fix the geometry on my motors and then everything else updates. So for example, if I go to a much bigger motor like that, like just automatically the outside and the inside are both run, it's the same code, so it automatically adapts. So do that, and I guess here I'm going to just drop this the top surface down. So I'm just grabbing the base of the motor, which I claim seems plausible. I've got a bunch of shape for the motors to be sticking up. Now I've got a little copper container for the motor. Now I want to stick the motor onto the frame somehow. So I claim the right way to do this is to have the frame as a separate module. So here's my frame 2D cross section. And I could have a fatten parameter just as well. Actually, fatten is super easy for 2D because it's just an offset. That's how to make things bigger. So lots of possible profiles for the frame. Actually, the one we've been using for robot mining is just one square inch steel tube. So it's just a square. And I'm going to center. So it's one inch. And this is always the problem with switching units. I mean, in America, we buy steel measured in inches, and you literally, it's hard to find, like, I want a 50 millimeter steel tube. Like, now you can get 2 inch, which is almost the same, turns out. Uh, Because basically, and this is my standard way to deal with this. I'll define inch as a variable, and it's equal to 25.4. That's millimeters per inch. So now, if I want it to be 1 inch, I just say 1 times inch, right? And that's that doesn't look too bad. That's pretty obvious what's happening there, hopefully. So kind of a nice simple way to mix our units together. So we got our 2D frame. Now this frame is going to have absolutely hard square outside edges. So let's see what those look like. So I'm just going to do a translate. So I don't know where the frame is supposed to be relative to this. So I guess I'll move minus 50 in the x-axis and then see what the frame looks like. So something like that. That was the minus direction. So you notice our frame has these hard square edges, and the actual steel tubing usually has got a little bit of rounding to it. It's because they start with a plate and they bend it. So usually there's a little bit of radius on the outside, especially. So there are several wacky ways to do this. So you could actually model these things one at a time. In a real CAD program, you'd click on this edge and say round it. It's not how you do this here. So I'm just declaring a variable called rounding, and that's going to be about 3 millimeters of rounding, maybe 2 millimeters of rounding. So all you do to make rounding is I'm going to do an offset with a negative rounding. So this made the whole thing smaller. Okay, that doesn't seem like what you want. And then I'm going to make the whole thing bigger. Negative rounding makes it all smaller. Positive rounding will make it bigger, but the corners are going to expand sort of like in a spherical way. Does that make sense? So it sounds like it wouldn't do anything to make it smaller and then make it bigger. But what this does is this actually softens the corners, because the sharp corners, they're sharp. You make it smaller, it's still sharp. You make it bigger, and they become round. We talked about this a week ago, and I didn't. It's pretty wacky. That looks a little bit more curved than I want. So I think I'm going to do rounding 1.5 and see what that looks like. Okay, so
I'm going to basically extrude this thing up into 3D and then try and figure out how I'm going to bolt something onto that.
So we have the same issue here where, for example, I have the 2D location of the frame. So, for example, I could do a linear extrude. And what's it?
Oh, I was just looking at the equals plus, and I'm used to plus equals.
I was saying radius equals positive rounding. Radius equals rounding is and this is radius equals negative rounding. Yeah, all this is that's a named variable going into the offset function. So that's the shape of the frame, and it's fairly easy to do. For example, I can do a difference here. So just the same way that so difference is going to do. So it somehow inflate the frame. So I could do a difference between the linear extrusion of the frame and the linear extrusion of the frame, the fattened version of the frame. So you notice I'm copying and pasting here, which feels wrong. This has to be the same height or a little bit greater. So frame height, so I'm just going to fatten this thing up by the wall thickness. I set a default parameter of 0 there. So I get the outside is the frame plus the wall thickness, and the inside is just the frame itself. So hopefully we have a hole through there. This is what happens when so both of these are the same height. A certain amount of this stuff may work if I press F6 so I may get a clean STL out of that. Yeah, OpenSCAD's smart enough to do that, but it looks ugly, and I've certainly had OpenSCAD just flip out because essentially all this is saying is the hole and the geometry that I'm subtracting the hole from are basically in the same plane, so it's just up to round off like which one shows up on top. This is not real reliable. So in particular, like if I got an object and I want to cut a hole straight through it, if you just make the hole a little bit bigger, so for example, I can add 0.1 millimeters, And now the top side of this thing is actually clean. The bottom side is still bad, which means I need to do a translate down. This is actually getting really ugly, I think. So this is the hold for the frame. And let's see, so I'm gonna translate. And I mean, it's not totally awful, but this is starting to look kind of unmaintainable. Oh, if I move the start point down, the bottom looks good, but the top is now round off because they end at the exactly same spot. So I make the whole thing longer, and now I got a hole clean through it. I don't know, that doesn't seem real compelling. Cool way to do this. Do everything you can in 2D. So here, I can do a difference on the 3D shapes, these extrusions. Or I can extrude the difference of the 2D shapes. So all I'm doing is I'm pulling this thing out. Nice part about 2D is there's a lot less opportunities for Z round off happening in there. So I can actually just blow away all this stuff. And, okay. So should be the same shape. Yeah, it's the same shape. And, okay, so what we've got is we've got...
frame, so we got somewhere we can wrap around the frame, and maybe the situation where we can slide this part of the bracket onto the frame, and then we can slide the motor in. So we just need to connect up these two shapes somehow.
How? Yeah. Well, lots of ways to do this. So, for example, we can just drop in a cube. So I want it to start somewhere like 25, I guess. Let's see. Why do we do the negative z? Let me do the positive in x. So that's just going to be on the other side. And then my cube is going to be 50 wide. It's going to be call it 50 high, and it's going to be wall thickness. Let's see, wall thickness in y and 50 high in z. So see if this gets close. Okay, so I claim this is actually a fairly common way to get complicated stuff built in OpenSCAD. So I'm going to, I'm just going to stick this thing on.
Now, of course, the some sort of connection actually looks relatively okay, except that it doesn't look like it has any strength at all. But the bigger problem here is that it's now impinging on geometry that was there before.
And you could fix this by carefully translating the cube and lining everything up, but there's an easier way. Yeah, so what I need is I need to put all of the subtractions to happen afterwards. I guess I just said do everything in 2D. Actually, if we're doing the motor in 2D, that would be cool too. Let's see. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a frame 3D module. So here's my frame in 3D, and it's actually fatten and insertion is probably about the right. We're probably going to need those things too. So this is just going to be a linear extrude. It's going to have extra height if you need to insert the frame in there. And let's see, so it's just going to basically do frame 2D and add the fatten. So let's see, so our whole object now is basically one of the tricks here is I'm going to add a bunch of stuff like outsides. I'm going to subtract a bunch of stuff like holes to put motors and things in. So you actually get a lot more composability if you do basically all of your additions and then all of your subtractions. Actually makes it a lot easier, like you can move one thing and not have it ramming the hole on another thing. So here's what we're gonna do is I'm gonna make a module. So here's my whole bracket. I usually call this like the positive half or the plus half, and plus. So I probably hardly need any parameters here, so it's good. But bracket plus is going to be the outside of the motor bracket, and see, it's going to be the outside of the frame. So I'm basically take the frame and fatten that thing up by the wall thickness. Let's see, I'm not going to have to insert that wall yet. Let's see. Oh, and if I have the reinforcing edge there, so this is the plate connecting the two sides. Okay, so then I'm going to put all of my subtractions in a different module. So here's my bracket minus. So it's basically just all the things we were subtracting off. So we'll have that motor shape. Just for debug, I can put this is the debug cross section. That's what let me see what's happening inside the middle of this thing. So we'll leave that as optional. Eventually we're gonna need a big difference. Okay, and then my motor I can put up here. So we're basically defining the motor, defining the frame, defining all the stuff we add, defining all the stuff we subtract. Okay, so we do need to subtract the frame. And it's gonna be unfattened, but does need some space to for the frame to even exist there. Okay, so hopefully we're about there. So now at the end of the day, this thing should just be the difference, my whole bracket. It's equal to the difference between bracket plus and minus, if that makes sense. So all of my additions, then all of my subtractions. Now, the nice part is that we should immediately blow away the parts of that the connecting plate that that would interfere with something else. So if you do that, and we lost frame. Oh, this should have been translated. Okay, so my frame, actually my frame, so anytime I find myself copying and pasting something, like this is the same translation, this is basically actually where the frame starts. So I could say frame start point is at the point 50.00. So I get the frame start point. There we are. Okay, so see, we have some rounding issues down there, but you notice we have something we could actually print. Now it depends on how much force this motor is undergoing. If the motor is basically just lifting a flag or spinning a sensor or something, this may be fine. I may have a lot more force happening. What's that?
Slap some glue on the motor before inserting it.
Well, the problem is this thin little plate like is gonna wobble left and right relative to the frame. So pretty easy to set up two, and this is just a matter of actually, so I could have a side. So I have a negative one and a positive one.
And
so
if you go with two, is you could do a infill two and select one of the
so hopefully
stronger,
I get two plates.
Infills.
Oh, right, let's see. So I got to translate by like, figure how far I need to translate. So I can manually tune in some kind of side plates to basically get about what I want. It's asymmetrical because this wall is going in the positive direction. Let's see. So I should actually subtract off half the wall thickness. Just for symmetry, you gotta have symmetry. This is relatively reasonable. Now what, so something like that, and of course you could just add additional geometry and then just tune the thing in to put cross bracing or whatever you wanted to do, or make a big solid block and let the infill do it, totally plausible. Now, in practice, it seems like I always end up in the situation where, that's how I start off thinking it was gonna be, and then it turns out the frame has to be like over here. And worse yet, the frame also has to be, like, to actually make this, whatever I'm doing, it has to clear the frame, so I actually need a rotation. So I'm going to put some angles on this thing. So this is going to be, so this starts to get really wacky. So my rotation, so my frame has got to be rotated. I'm going to make it simple and just a rotation along the x-axis to start with. So I'm going to translate to the frame start. I'm going to rotate into the frame orientation. So rotate, frame, rotate. So again, rotation, just a primitive there. Let's see. Arguably, I should put this stuff into frame, but let me do that, actually. So you can totally refactor this stuff. This is one thing I really like. I realize, the frame really just lives in one spot. So if I'm doing the frame, I should just put the translation and rotation to put the frame in the right location when I make a frame, and then I don't have to do everything twice here. So draw it. Okay, so my frame is now rotated, and you notice like it took out part of my bracket there, which this is one of the things I really love about OpenSCAD, is that I've kind of defined how I want the constraints of this thing to operate. Now the problem is, how do I put these plates in such a way that they're going to hold on to the outside of the frame, like So making the plates actually work or do something rational suddenly seems like not so easy.
I'd almost say find like the average center point between the frame and the motor housing. And I don't know if two planes is the correct reinforcement at this point.
Yeah.
But you could run your two planes along like the average axis of them.
Yeah. Yeah, so in particular, you could imagine like saying, okay, I got these, and I'm going to rotate these, so I'm just going to manually like try and figure out like, well, 24 degrees and, you know, 13 and Y or something, right? Like, so tune in some wacky three-dimensional rotation. Yeah, that's kind of, they look a little drunk or something. So the main problem is this doesn't really, this is not a very scalable, and it's not easy or reliable or pretty or clean, or there's nothing good about this. I claim there's an easier way to do sort of brackets.
Oh, that's good.
Here's how I'm going to suggest doing brackets. So I get these two objects, and what I want is I want basically like oftentimes if I'm trying to hold two objects together, the best place to hold on to them is on their outsides, basically.
Okay.
So this is actually really similar to the way we made walls around things by just making it fatter. So what if I could just make this whole glob of stuff fatter, and particularly the space in between these fatter? So there's a primitive that does this called convex hull. So I'm just going to show you I'm just doing this on the positive side. So if you do it on the positive side, so you can see what we just made is we made a solid block that holds these two things together. And actually looks, I like this because it looks pretty. Yeah, it doesn't look quite as good. Like if the frame starts like way up in the Z or something, then looks a little bit weird. But I mean, it looks engineered as hell, right? It looks pretty cool. And actually, so just this may be enough, right? I could just do infill. And then it'll print solid walls, and it'll do, you know, as much as I tell it to do on the sides of that thing. So convex hull, and then so I didn't do a convex hull in the subtraction phase. You can actually do a little bit better. So let's see. So we've got each of the minuses, I think, is extending further. So if you do, so they're extending out like that. So what if I took the convex hull of the minuses? That would, I think this would give me basically just the exterior perimeters. So let's see, so what I'm gonna subtract off of here, and this is where this, so you can see we basically have almost, there's almost no code left here, right? Like the plus basically just says, yep, there's motor and frame. And if I do a convex hull of the minuses, then this, I claim this is actually relatively good that I've got those things. So.
Okay.
This seems not so good.
Well, it's you have outside support, but you don't have inside support.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, let's see. So somehow this worked out way better. It totally depends on what your rotations look like. So, for example, if I'm rotating along a different axis, if everything is lined up right, so there are times when you can just automatically get these walls connecting things. Something a little curious about this. I think the fact that my motor is not convex means that it's not quite behaving the way I'm used to. So we can kind of auto-generate some fancy walls. Now the problem here is like the frame is not really held in, right? The frame can pivot up, the motor can pivot out. So that's no good. So maybe we do another pass here. So I'm gonna do a difference of, okay, so I'm gonna do bracket plus, bracket minus. This basically gives me my walls. And then I'm going to do kind of another pass, which is more conventional, just actually the, so I got plus and minus. So can I do hull outside here? Yes, I can. I should actually probably be doing the hull on the outside of the plus and minus functions, so that then I can do a non-hulled version. So and that'll be like the interior brackets, just like we were doing before. So I got a bracket plus, bracket minus, that gives me the exterior walls, so here's the outside walls. And then I'm going to do a difference between, gosh, this gets really complex, union of the, just the per part bracket plus stuff. And the halls are only there to do the outside walls. Okay, I've stuck those together, and then I'm clearing space again through the outside walls. Oh my gosh. So this is basically like the stuff we had before plus these new wacky walls. And then you could add on, for example, so I've totally had it where you do this and then you put in a few manual things and you find the center lines and do like in little gates or something. You can make these things as complex as you want. Cool part about this is that there's a lot about this that honestly the version of convex hull without doing anything, this actually seemed a lot more scalable because the brackets get really hard to design when things are at weird angles, right? Like there's this three-dimensional shift and rotation happening in there, so it just makes it hard to pull off. I guess in this case our frame has to stop right there. So if we wanted that to not be true, we could just set up frame 3D so that this does a translate first. So if we have insertion in both directions, so I've just extended the hole.
Yep.
So now it's carved out a hole for that thing. And then we need space for the motor wires. That's absolutely true. So in this case, they get really organic, yeah.
And
it's really hard to machine a thing like this, like if you're doing subtractive machining, because it's all rounded edges, and there's no obvious way to do the work place to do the work holding. Actually, there's a problem here that this has no flat surface that I can put on the build platform. So we'll see how we could fix that in a sec. So let's see. So I need to poke a hole in the motor housing for wires to come out. So what I'm going to do is basically just say this is a cylinder. And it's going to be however big your wires are. So I guess here all the wires are right on the outsides. So I'm going to cheat for the moment and pretend that they're 10 millimeter diameter and that the height is insertion. So this hopefully just poked a hole right through the middle. The flashing is due to we started at zero and we went down. So what I'm going to do is translate up a tad. So I'm gonna carve my hole starting a little bit higher. So then okay, so that cuts all the way through. And let's see, so now I guess I need to do two copies. So have a left side and a right side. And I'm gonna translate to however wide the motor is, like 15. So I get my two motor wiring holes subtracted out of there. Actually, that's too close to the frame, so I'm going to rotate. Let's see. So I should do the translations on the y-axis, not the x-axis. So now I get space for my wires to come out. You could be as complex as you want to be there. So we have one remaining problem, which is this is going to be hard to print because it doesn't sit flat on any surface. How do we fix that?
Subtract off
On the bottom.
Yep.
And that way, when you do the infill, it'll flatten it out.
Yep. So all I'm doing is difference of the union of all this stuff. I carved holes in everything. Actually, this isn't even a difference anymore. I'm basically just doing the outside walls. So then I'm going to trim the bottom flat. One thing it really needs is a half space. It doesn't have a half space.
So what I need just some giant flat object that ends at z equals zero.
What could I use for that? Yeah, so actually my traditional way to do this is just a giant cube, like 2,000 by 2,000 by 2,000, and it's centered. So the problem, of course, is if I difference with that, that occupies everything. So I need to shove it down so it ends right at z equals 0. What translation is that? So this always happens when I do subtractions. Apparently, that's not it. So if we look at it, let's see. Oh, yeah, it's way down there. Clipping starts to do weird stuff there. So it's too far. So we told it to center. So it's a total of 2,000 units wide, and it's plus 1,000 from its center point. So we go down by minus 1,000, and then hopefully we get this half plane. So it's a little bit weird because it's so huge it like occupies the camera no matter which direction you look at it. So okay, we've got this nice trim bottom flat. So okay, we have a nice flat surface. Oh, there's Z buffer fighting happening right in there. Oh, that's annoying. Actually, if we trim it at Z equals 0, then we don't really have, in particular if I do an F6 here. You know, Seagal has to kind of think about it now. We actually have no bottom. Meaning the motor is going to kind of want to fall out of there. That's no good. So I'm going to do minus 1,000 minus wall. So that's actually going to trim me like lower in Z. So I'm going to leave wall thickness material down at the bottom. Okay, so what we got here is we got enough wall right there. We get, yeah, so this actually looks plausible. So the cool part about this is that now, so I can do F6. I can export my STL. STL is not going to, so will I need support material here, and will this thing print worth beans?
Well, everything looks reasonable.
What do you think? Will that print without support? One problem would be like a little bit of stuff dangling down in... So as it's printing this thing, so we've got our sparse infill in there. Actually, you could probably turn infill down quite a ways there. Let's see. So yeah.
Depends on. I think the infill.
This one is definitely okay, I think. This one is a little more.
Is this structure going to experience
that? That is totally the question. So you could crank the infill way up. You could. Cool part about this thing being parametric. You print it, you strap it on the robot, and this motor is like. See, you realize. Okay, yeah, we need more infill, and actually the, the walls are 2 millimeters thick. So you could say, well, you know, if it's bouncing all over the place, let me do 4 millimeter thick walls. Now watch what else changes here. Boom. Like the hole stays the same size. I mean, the motor's still going to fit. The walls are now thicker. The floor is now thicker. The walls around everything are thicker. Like, boom, ready to print. Like, that's cool. Somebody wants to redesign the entire shape of the robot, and now, instead of being at a 30-degree angle, it's at a 15-degree angle. Like, that's cool. What if? Right? You literally have to change nothing, right? Like, it's just like, yep, sure, cool. I mean, it takes me...
You could set the frame
I guess
rotation as a variable, too, up top, so you just look it up and... It
starts to get a little bit weird if you wrote... So this is what goes wrong with parametric CAD. So, for example, if, we were thinking, the frame is oriented like that, if the frame ends up like these, then what do we do in this case?
Ooh. Well, you'd have to...
Because we're not even really holding onto the frame at this point.
You'd have to either... Well, if you can't change that orientation, you'd have to make your floor... You'd have to move it up somehow and make your floor a lot thicker.
Yeah, so there's actually a cheap trick here. Which is all I need to do is rotate this whole part without rotating this plane. So actually, it turns out to be pretty easy. Oh, except this is all in the trimming part. I'm going to do as a separate op down here. So here's a difference. So the trimmed bracket would basically be the whole bracket. It's just got this cube subtracted off of it. It would be really easy to rotate the cube, except slicers all assume Z is flat, right? We gotta have flat along the Z axis. So here I can just actually rotate the bracket backwards. So I'm just gonna try and tilt it, oh my gosh, three dimensions. Three dimensional rotation is like the hardest thing for me to figure out.
Okay, we get the y-axis. I want a negative rotation. So it'd
be like negative 20 in y. So 0 minus 20. It's probably too much. Yeah, that rotates it all the way off the ground. So let's do negative 10. Okay. And then you can just dial this in. There's actually probably some trig you could do if you had to be, okay, negative 8. If you had to do this a lot, you could probably put in the trig and just bake in, you know, what rotation you want. Now, this is a little bit weird because we're actually adding extra material you don't need under the motor. It's kind of like built-in support material. But Convex Hull did tons of that anyway. So let's see. So we rotate. I guess I got to rotate a little bit more. You can actually rotate on two axes here. So now we can do a x-axis rotation of 3 degrees. And this is the sort of thing that gets, really hard to do this kind of thing with conventional machining, just because, let's see, 12. The angles, setting up the angles gets really nasty. So I'm going to do 10-degree rotation down and can rotate up a little more.
3D printed part where it's like an order of magnitude cheaper than the original is, it took over 100 milling operations to make this part the traditional way. Where they'd mill it, they'd weld parts together, they'd mill it some more, weld more parts together.
Stuff like rocket engines, where you anything with cooling passages. Like ideally, the cooling passages are going in 3D, in these weird shapes, and like there's no way to have a milling cutter that's like reaching around the corner and, you know, extending this curved hole. So it, the 3D printing can really simplify. Okay, so we just printed that thing. Oh, we're ramming into the bottom there, so we just need to fatten up the bottom a little bit, or adjust, I don't know. Maybe this is okay. Trying to figure out how to print it is like maybe the ideal face to print it would be to trim off like part of this extra fat this side or something. But then maybe you get to worry about support material up there or something. Thing I love about this is like, you know, this is literally under 100 lines of code. And the thing that's glorious about this is it really just, I can go back into an old design and I can change a lot of stuff. And you know, somebody says, "Oh, you know, my wiring actually needs a tie down." So you can just, you know, stick on a little, you know, some sort of little tie down for the wiring to get zip tied onto there, no problem. Actually, it's super easy to do a passageway for a zip tie to go through, and just drop that into the part that exists. Let me show how you would do this. My rotations, somehow I'm not really feeling the rotations here, so I'm going to try and drop off most of these rotations. Okay. So we got a basically flat surface to start with. So these wires are going to come out of here, and we're going to need to zip tie them down. And you really got to make sure your wiring stays secure. So probably on this side is the ideal. There's the little coordinate axis down there. Helps you stay oriented, hopefully. Okay, so I've got So it's going to be negative y, positive x. So you can just guesstimate, or you can figure this out based on the, you know, sizes of things. For stuff like this, probably just guesstimating. So what I want is I want a little passageway for a zip tie to arc through there. What primitives do I use to make this?
Let's see here.
If you've done it before, like. Call the module that subtracts the shape of a zip tie, and I totally like steal little bits of code that I've tuned in.
I'd say it is a rectangular cylinder.
Actually, just a square hole going through there would probably be
square
okay.
Hole, yeah.
So it's basically just going to be a long cube. So this is like the zip tie slot. So it's a cube. It's the width of a zip tie. So especially in X, that's the width of the zip tie, which depends on the zip tie you're using. I'm going to call it 10. Let's see, it's 3 is probably way excessive in the Y direction. And then Z is going to be how we're going to cut all the way through it. So I'm going to call it 100. So that dimension is just way excessive. So I'm going to translate this thing over to the start point. So the start point is going to be something like just total wild guess here of 30 minus 20. And then I'm going to rotate. Let's see. Actually, in Z, it needs to start. Yeah. So I think I'm going to center this. center usually makes rotations look a little better. Okay, so I'm gonna, I wanna rotate it, so it starts off, cube facing up along the z-axis. I want my cube to be there, so that's, I guess, a positive rotation around the x-axis, right-hand rule. So I figure all those things out, so 40 degree angle or so. So hopefully we got a, yeah, and, oh, hey, first try. It looks huge. That is actually 1 inch. It's okay, and I'm way too close to the edge there, so I'm gonna go 20. And I can probably probably get away with like an 8 by 2. You make it too small, zip tie doesn't really fit through there. And I guess it should be facing more toward the inside just to keep the wires more protected. So this rotation should be like 70. Questions? Let's see. Oh, I guess if it's going to be printed, it's going to be full of spaghetti.
It's short enough, maybe it'll bridge okay. I don't know.
So a lot of these things, you just have to try a print, see if see what goes horribly wrong. I wish I could say different, but. So lots of ways to do this. So for example, if time is short, I basically make my best guess and I do the one print. And if this is the only bracket I ever need, like, yep, just get the hot glue gun and stick more plastic on where you need it, or get the, you know, just clamp it in the drill press and like, you know what, we need a space for a zip tie. Drill. Yep. I mean, so you can just mod this part post printing. If you're going to make like 50 of them, then you clearly want to, you know, do a couple iterations and get the STL exactly right, so it prints just perfect, right? It comes out of there, motor just drops in there perfectly. Oh, you know, one thing we didn't put in here. So again, this is just sort of post modifications. The motor like just falls in there. I mean, motor's whole job is to rotate. Motor's exerting torque on things, right? Unlike the frame, so the frame,
The frame can take torque because it's not.
Yeah, it's not going to rotate. But you know what? The frame is going to slide along here. So let me show you how you would. So how would we secure something to the frame?
Well,
it's
my first
steel tube.
Was glue.
You could glue it on. Yeah, actually, that's plausible.
But
I've had cases where like double-sided duct tape, especially, you kind of just put a thin little layer of it on there. And then slide it in so it just gets smashed into the boundary, and then seems like might be pretty good. If you want this thing to be addable and removable, or like I want to be able to adjust it,
that's where you might want to have a nut or something to go into.
Yeah.
You know, have a nut on the frame piece, and you put a screw in to lock it down.
And we can totally do this exact same kind of thing. We can just go and say like, oh, okay, we need space for a bolt. Sometimes you'll get lucky and they'll be that way. Oftentimes the key is like a tiny little, like, so this one has a key that's like 3 millimeters wide. So conceivably you could actually just, we could
have put a flat spot in there that it goes into. But
yeah. So we just engineer that into right there. I mean, there are certainly cases where, for example, you end up using the wires accidentally as the preventing the motor from rotating, and that's really
awfully stressful. And
yeah, not good long term. So so the bolt to hold the frame down. So it's just basically a cylinder hole. Cylinder.
Some power tools use a. They use the nut that holds the gearing. They use the torque from you know on the nut from that pressure to allow it to do. So I mean there are many options.
So I've got this little mounting hole for the frame. Now what I want to do is I want to put that mounting hole basically on the frame and in the frame orientation. So the way I got the frame in the right orientation was some rotates and translates, etc. Actually, there's a great trick for this, which is module frame orientation. And the idea here is we're gonna factor out the rotates and translates. Now, what I want to do is I want to be able to basically do frame orientation. And then that will do the rotates and translates for here. Did we talk about this last time?
Children.
Yeah, so what I want to do here is children. And this calls everything below there. So I made frame orientation a function, and now I can call it from down here. So when I'm making the, so that probably starts me off in some, like, the base of the thing or something, so. Okay, so we're oriented relative to the frame, and now if I move the frame around, like, the hole will move with the frame, which is good. So, let's see, so now I just got to translate up. Probably I just need to rotate this thing. Oh my gosh, this would be a positive 90 rotation to put the cylinder facing the right way. Rotate around Y. So, do that, okay. Oh, I centered it. Let me not center it. Okay, so now we just need to figure out where that bolt goes. So translate, and however high you want the bolt. So right at the end, or so that M3 hole looks kind of small, actually. I mean, I guess one I guess would be enough here. So what do we pick here? We picked a 2-inch chunk of frame, so going 1 inch here would probably be the symmetric way to do it, or it looks better. So it's not going to rotate along. Actually, yeah, M3 is probably enough to keep the thing from moving.
It all depends upon the stress. If it encounters too much stress, well, that's where you manually go to a bigger bolt later on, or if you're printing a lot of them and your testing showed that it wasn't enough, well, then you increase it in the frame.
So there's this other problem that, we've got the frame locked down. The motor is actually likely to kind of slip out of there, rotate in place, like bad things are going to happen. So I claim we need some way to, like, hold that on. Glue would be an option, like if we were willing to, like, permanently affix the motor in there.
There's glue. If it has a bolt that you can plug into there somewhere.
But I guess we could do the same deal, right? Just have, like, a through bolt. Drilling and tapping a motor is a little scary.
Well,
like,
no, that's why I'm saying is
pushing.
The motor has a mounting point.
Yeah.
I mean, they have to have something on that motor designed for allowing it to exert force.
I think it's they're usually supposed to be, like, the face plate is mounted on here, and of course we're misusing it in a million ways already.
That's where you put a hex bolt on. You put a hex thing in the top,
Firstly, the bottom would have to be open.
Well, no, it's what I'm saying is you drop the motor in, and you have a hex plate on top that you put in afterwards.
So you put a steel plate over top.
Then holds it in.
Lots and lots of ways to do this. One way I kind of like is if we cut a slit in the plastic, then we can actually have the plastic act like a little clamp. So all we got to do is put one bolt to squish the sides of the plastic together. Yeah. So let's see. So I'm pretty close. I think I'm just going to do this along the y-axis, and then we can rotate later if we got to fix that. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to have the clamp slot. Let's see. I'm going to make this really easy to do this in the positive y-axis. So this would be I'm in the difference list here. So my bracket. So I start with a positive bracket, and then I'm subtracting off space for the motors, space for the zip ties. So subtractions are actually really easy to do here. So my clamping slot is going to be basically. It's a cube. It's going to be as high as I want it. So it's going to be facing basically along the y-axis here. So I'm going to make it pretty thin in x, like, I don't know, 1 millimeter thick in x. And then in y, it's got to basically just extend forever. And in z, it extends forever. So I basically just, so what I did is just cut a slot in the motor all the way along there. Probably shouldn't start that close down to the wires. Well, maybe that's okay. So I'm gonna try and clamp it on mostly at the top where it starts getting wide. So I don't have any way to put bolts in here. So I can just add more geometry to the outside of that thing to add a space for bolts to clamp on. And this can literally be as simple as just like, yep, just add me a box. So this is the This is the boss around the, so extra plastic around the outside of the clamp, and now I gotta figure out how big it should be. Gosh, so here we are, diameter 37 plus wall. So several ways to do this. One is to pull out the motor size. So here's my motor diameter. If I have that available as a variable, then I can compute everything parametrically, which is the right way to do it. So motor diameter. So how far out I go here is basically motor. So I'm gonna figure out how big the boss is. So the boss has gotta be at least 6 millimeters high. So I'm going to go motor diameter. Now here I'm starting in the middle of the shape and I'm going out. So I wanna extend motor diameter plus the wall thickness plus the boss height. It's motor diameter over 2 because I basically just go, I'm starting from the center line. So I'm basically making a cube that's going to start in the middle and it's going to work its way out here. I guess I need a variable for the motor height. So this is my total height of the motor. And I just need this to get the boss in the right spot. So here's my motor Z. So see what we got there. Oh, wacky. Oh, it shouldn't be 1 millimeter thick. It should be boss thickness. Okay, so we got an extra little wedge of stuff there to clamp into. Hopefully, it actually needs to extend in both directions there. So this should be twice boss, and this should be translated back in X. So keeping track of the coordinate system is really hard here. So minus boss. And of course, you could clean this up as much as you want. So I've got this nice little blob, this little wedge. Oh, it's asymmetrical. That cannot stand. Sorry. Slot is 1.0 thick. So I'm going to translate back by the half the width of the slot. And then so here's my slot width. And it's centered in X. That's okay. Order has been restored to the universe. So now you just got to drill some holes in that manually after the fact. We can do it with some subtractions here. We can actually make everything parametric, and you could first pick a fastener to use to drop the thing in. M3s are sure nice. Yeah.
Or M3s.
Yeah. The boss should be 6 millimeter diameter, which is exactly the diameter of the M3 bolt head. Yeah. Well, they have a hex key. So
I was thinking about on the back side where you're
screwing
the bolt in.
Yeah. So lots of options. I've actually had cases where I'm just like an M3 taps into plastic. Fairly okay. It's not really a high strength connection.
Well, yeah, you should probably put a nut trap or something.
I'm thinking on this one, it would have to be a high strength connection because you're trying to clamp that motor down.
Yep. And a lot of the stuff, yeah, depends on thermal, depends on the loads, depends on all sorts of stuff. Okay, let's do a little row of mounting bolts, and then we can call it a day on this one. So my clamp boss height. So again, I can make local variables for stuff I'm just going to use right now. So here's my clamp bolt holes, and you can make these as complex as you want, but it's kind of been a while. So this is a little bit weird. My bolt Z.
I don't know really how many bolt holes I should have. I mean, you know, have a couple of them in there.
I know I want to basically start, you know, not quite at the bottom here, so I'm going to start, let's see. So I'm going to start at like 20 millimeters, and I'm going to end, so I'm going to take step size TBD, and I'm going to end at motor Z. So they have a really nice range-based for syntax that I kind of I covet this in C++. So colons are their normal range-based for. So if I go from 20 to motor Z, it'll be every millimeter, which is way too many bolts. I can indicate the step size. So I can say do this every inch, but up to motor Z. So inch is just a constant, 25.4. There's my bolt Z. So my for loop will start at 20, and it'll go up by 1 inch until it gets past motor Z. So I'm going to translate to that Z, and I guess I'm going to drop in my cylinder, so I'm gonna start with a 3 millimeter bolt and see what that looks like. And I bet you my bolt is facing the wrong way. They always seem to. I don't know what I did here. So this would be actual surfaces. Yeah, so I don't seem to have bolt holes. Where'd they go? Oh, they're centered. Right, okay. So I gotta translate them out, basically. It's this. So you could write a function that would get you over to the boss area. So hopefully, okay, they're hiding in there. They're facing vertically, so I want them to be rotated in the y-axis. So. Okay, it's apparently only two. Actually, two looks semi-plausible. So yeah, in here, instead of just having the through hole, you could put a nut trap, you could put as much fanciness as you wanted there, you could bevel off the edges if you felt like that was important, you could radius the inside corners if you felt like that was important. Actually, the radiusing is quite easy to do. Radiusing, I'm just going to take that boss and include it in the convex hull. So this clamp boss, just move the curly braces around. And now the boss is like integrated and it's super thick now. But that's now indestructible. Now you'd really need to dig in and make connections for your bolts. So just move the curly braces around to be inside or outside the convex hull, right? That's the only difference. Questions about this madness? You can make arbitrarily complex parts, and they can actually be maintainable. So I've done a lot of robot parts and brackets, and brackets seem like all a robot is, basically. It's like, get a bunch of off-the-shelf parts, get some basic steel, and then brackets hold everything together. But I've done bracket designs or complex multi-part designs for wheels and things. And I've done them in lots of other packages, and the big problem is when you realize, like, I gotta refactor. Sometimes the only way to do it is to just, like, rewind all of your, undo all of your geometry modifications until you're at that step, and do it a different way, and then repeat everything, which is just very labor-intensive. Whereas here, if I realize, you know, this clamp boss thing is getting, like, ridiculously complex, I should have a module for this. So there should be a module clamp minus. You can totally just do that. You can say, like, yeah, let me just grab all of the clamp stuff and drop that into this module. So here's clamp minus. Yeah, we could reuse it. Yeah, maybe we need one on the left and one on the right or something. Apparently I screwed some. Oh, boss now needs to be dragged out as a global variable. A lot of the stuff about the clamp should probably be more, should be more modular. So maybe, so the thing I like about this is you can actually go back and refactor. And you can realize, like, I keep saying this all the time. Let me just make a variable for that, find and replace all occurrences of that, and say, yeah, this is the new variable. And now if I use it in some different way, then it should all automatically change. And I should be able to say, you know what, now that we got the boss on there and we upgraded filament or something, I can do thinner walls, and, like, it all works, right? Nothing, I don't really have to refix a bunch of stuff, typically. So the parts seem a lot more maintainable in OpenSCAD if you can get over the syntax. So for example, one thing I might want to do, like, I might realize, you know, this is great, the clamp works perfectly, it's just the clamp needs to be on this side because there's something that needs to go right by this side. Like, in a lot of CAD programs, like, oh my gosh, I can't just mirror the part because this is asymmetrical. Maybe got other asymmetry in there. So here, all I want to do is I want to basically just add a new rotation to my clampy stuff. So I could just have a clamp rotate. Or actually, the scalable way to do this is probably just to make a clamp orientation. So it will do a rotate of, let's see, in the Z 180.
You can have it on the exact opposite side of the
yeah, just flip it around.
Support beam.
Yeah. So now if I just put all the clamp stuff in clamp orientation and maybe it should be folded into clamp minus sometimes, if Joe, I mean, that's easy enough. Right. Yeah, and if it if you think, yeah, you know, I like that, let's do even more of that. So so you could fold the clamp into the frame a little bit there, like if you need even more space. Maybe it's stronger if you can make really long bolts and tap them in there.
You might have to pry it apart, stick a hex nut in
yeah.
on the other side.
Yeah. Or during the print, you pause it and drop in the hex reinforcement.
It seems it would be hard to
yeah.
just drop one in during the print for,
yep.
for that because it's not the right orientation. But.
Mm-hmm. Questions? Does this seem exciting? Is it... I should so let me show you some of the fun other stuff.
I see this as pointing out that 3D printing is more of a technique. It's an additional tool in the manufacturing box.
Absolutely.
A replacement for the
yeah.
box.
Yeah. And in particular there are times when like you know, I have a round part and I need really good tolerances, I need really flat surfaces. The only way to get that is on a lathe, basically, at the moment. I mean, but the printer, like, you know, I can't do like a, you know, a perfect, you know, sub fraction of inch, at least on my printer. So I'll print like a bigger thing, chuck it up on the lathe, and then just, you know, smooth off the things that need to be smoothed off, and that's totally doable.
What I'm thinking about is there's techniques out there for like when you're 3D printing models to chemically treat the printed product to smooth out the
that's cool. Yeah.
Jaggies.
Yeah.
Or you know, even let's face it, sandpaper.
So this was all we had to do was mount some Vive brackets on a this NASA provided like scoring area. So this ended up being like 2D seemed to be work great for all of this stuff. So you can see, I mean, the first thing I got in my OpenSCAD is I've got a bunch of constants defined. So epsilon is like avoid round off and you know shift things so that they that everything lines up. Let's see, so and almost all the stuff is like 2D. Actually, so apparently I made a little module that just rounds the edges.
And you see the technique it does for that is shrink things and then inflate them again.
So that's how I automatically get like all the round all of the inside edges, round all the outside edges, just round all the edges. Makes the part like not cut into your hands as bad. Let's see. So I don't think there's too much happening here. So I guess I do a convex hull between. So to make this circular extrusion thing, like I know how deep the bin wall is. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's this circle, and then it just extends off a little ways. I have the clip, so the clip is up here, and apparently I did a polygon to make this this shape, I believe. So basically, stick that to the bin wall, and then the cross brace diagonals. Oh my gosh, ew. The cross brace diagonals. I don't know if you can see what's happening there, but I have a top and a bottom. So I'm basically saying, take all possible combinations of top and bottom and make a convex hull with a dot connecting the two sides. Hmm. So you automatically get the cross braced. So basically just gotta specify like where these connect. So if I'm reading this right, so like my top X, oh that's X equals zero. So if I say, you know what, this thing should actually be at, should be a negative X by 20 or so. So I can move that 1 point. And I guess that starts everything over there. So you can shift things around if it needs better support under there. Right. Oh, I see. I cheated even more. Like this is just a translate. So I just I do a top translation. So if you wanted the bottom to be wider, the top side to be wider. Yeah. So if, I don't know. It gets a little bit weird. But basically, like I'm just specifying these point locations, and I just have the for loop just does convex hulls to make all possible combinations. All this stuff gets unioned together into a big filleted, nice rounded thing. If I did the subtractions correctly, like and I think no, apparently I did not do them correctly here. But yeah, so So you end up like, this is like, I got 100 lines of code or something. And at some point I think I had a lot more 3D stuff happening here. This is a little weirdly 2D. So let me see if I can find, I had one where I was mounting a connect. And not here, apparently. So yeah, the idea was to just grab onto a connect and right. So I guess almost out of time. In the lecture notes, there's a million examples of wacky stuff that I've done that are pretty fun. There's complete 3D printers that are all done with this. Oh, let's see. You can do animation. So $T lets you see what's animating here. Sure, back to OpenSCAD. So I'm just gonna save that and make a new part. So if I do, like, it's cube, I need to turn on animate, and I get this wacky little control here. So I'm gonna see if I can hit 20 frames per second. I probably should. So I'll do 100 steps at 20 frames per second. So it's a little bit weird how FPS is the playback rate. Steps is how many steps it gets from t equals 0 to t equals 1. So this can actually be kind of handy for just seeing how things move. Like you just have moving parts and you drive t. So if it's supposed to translate, I just multiply by the $t variable built in. And it all it's doing is recomputing that stuff. So this is actually it's the same stuff that we've seen before. So for example, I can do a difference. It's recompiling as I run there, so I can do a difference between a big cube, 50-55. And this little rotating cube. So now there's the difference, like swings in and swings out. So that there's the cube shaped hole. So it's doing the constructive solid geometry stuff in real time. So yeah.
If you had a really complicated design you wanted to animate, could you render it slower than real time and then play it back?
Dump pictures. Yeah, and it'll let you make a movie. Yeah, because something kind of hairy tends to flicker a lot. So if I do the cube plus a sphere, I guess as I'm rotating, that's probably just like a timing bug. It's busy redrawing it for the animate when it's redrawing it for the rotate or something. You end up with blank space. So the next homework problem. Oh, I guess that was a big difference, wasn't it? So let me union first. It's weird. Common trick. So it feels like difference should only take two parameters, but there's lots of times when I want to start with a thing and then subtract a bunch of stuff off of it. So they say the first thing is positive and subsequent things are negative. Stuff totally works, and it works like off center translate. What? Questions? As far as a homework, how detailed do you want me to get? Because I was definitely thinking like do an OpenSCAD design is arguably too open-ended. That being the problem, yeah. So I could say make an OpenSCAD design that uses union and subtraction and some modules to do something that makes sense to you, not just like random, like even like drawing a snowman, right? Like snowman, the aesthetics. Are the eyes like inset? Are they outset? How do you? And then as soon as I can get you access to the printers downstairs, then the idea is actually think about how you would 3D print the design, because that's also important. Sure. I don't have you physical access yet. So could consider this homework out. I will put that on the homepage in a sec here. But basically, yeah, make an OpenSCAD design that uses some of the fancy OpenSCAD features, some variables, some modules, some to do something that that you actually care about, and try and make it, you know, I mean, comments really matter. That's one of the few ways I was able to look at this old stuff that I'd done and make it updated. So hopefully that's all we got on OpenSCAD for this class.